This is the Pulse Show, our first episode right here on Desert Radio 95.3 in Windhoek and the surrounding areas, 105.6 frequency modulation in Oshakati and the surrounding areas. Catching us crystal clear on DSTV, audio bouquet 839, GoTV 318. We stream on desertradio.fm. This has been a very interesting month of Movember. Moustache November. We had a series of talks. We started with general hygiene, where we were talking to men about just general hygiene, brushing your teeth, cutting your hair, cutting your nails, and reducing that perspiration with using ordinary soap, antiperspirant, the antiperspirant that suppresses the normal commensal bacteria underneath your armpits. We spoke about fungal infection that affects all your warm areas. And we said to you, make sure that you keep that place dry. Just use normal talc and also use a prophylactic cream of antifungal. Good afternoon to you, wherever you find yourself in the car, at home, in the office. Yes, today we are starting our first program, The Pulse. Today in the studio, I'm with Tangeni Amupadhi, our chief here at the Namibian newspaper. We also got in the studio Dr. Golda Stelmacher, who's going to be talking to us about prostate health. As I said, we started this month celebrating Movember, and we attended to all those main topics that affect men. As I said, general hygiene, general checkups. General checkups, basically, we're talking about you going to your GP, and your GP does head-to-toe examination. Head, it means on the head, you'll check your scalp, still check for fungal infections on your scalp or any other disease that might affect your scalp. Also, go to your eyes, do a eye checkup, go to your ear, nose and throat, check those. If there's any problem, you'll be referred to your ear, nose and throat specialist. Go to your mouth, send you through to your dentist to go check anything on the palate, sublingually, meaning under your tongue, on your cheeks, on your lips. Those are usually affected by things like squamous cell carcinoma. Squamous cell carcinoma is a cancer that affects the top part, the epidermis of your skin. Usually, it would be through high UV light from the sun. If you're baking yourself there in the coast during December, take into cognizance that the UV light, especially in Namibia, it's very high. You might find there's a cloud, but you still get burnt. And then what exacerbates the squamous cell carcinoma is things like smoking, things like drinking. And if you smoke continuously, you cause the mutation of the cells. Mutation of the cells means the cells, the DNA gives the directive to the cells to multiply, but they multiply wrongly. That means wrong cells multiply, so you end up with a problem in your mouth where you've got a cancer, and that cancer can only be sorted out by a dentist. Or a specialist, that is maxillofacial and oral surgeon, and also periodontists will be able to help you with any cancer cells that are in your mouth. Also the snuff. Other people use snuff, then they put it under their tongue. It also causes mutation of the cells. And then if there's any problem, as we go down to tonsils, it will be a specialty of an ENT. They can remove the tonsils if there's a need to, and then go down into your esophagus, which is also affected by smoking and also too much drinking. You go down to the liver. The liver is affected mostly by alcohol and other drugs, because it is a main organ that detoxifies whatever comes into your body. You go to the lungs will be affected by smoke usually, or it will be affected by your consumption of things that causes the main problem of breathing. And then your doctor then can send you for bloods. It's either to check for the full blood count. Also, full blood count, you want to see the platelets, how your clotting system works, your full blood count, your red cells, because the red cells are the one that transport oxygen from your lungs to other body parts. And amongst those tests that will be required, it will be for diabetes and for PSA, prostate specific antigen. That's what we're going to talk about as we wrap up this month of November, Today we've got Dr. Golda Stelmacher, who's going to talk about to us about just general prostate health. Good afternoon, Doctor.
Good afternoon, listeners.
Doctor, can you just go through what prostate health means?
Okay, I think we need to start with the prostate itself. The prostate is a sex gland, and important if you're over a certain age to be examined. And then it depends what your history is, how often the examination should be. But it is vital for men after the age of 35, if they have a history of prostate cancer, and a little bit older when you just have BPH. So the family history is very important.
So basically, what do we look at when we look at prostate health? When do you do an examination? Let me say I'm a GP. Mm-hmm. I refer the patient to you and I say, Dr. Stelmacher, I did this test and the PSA was high. So what are we looking? What range are we looking at? If for us to conclude that this is this requires attention.
Yeah. Okay. So a child is not born with a prostate. It develops later.
Yeah.
After the teenage years.
Mm.
So we rarely test people for cancer before the age of 35.
Yeah.
We don't.
Mm.
Only if we now divide the prostate in about three things. We'll talk about prostate cancer, BPH, and then prostatitis.
Yeah.
So if we start with prostate cancer, it a family history is very important.
Yeah.
And where people don't know their fathers or the father's family or the mother's family, then it is better to be proactive and actually examine the patient as if there is a history of prostate cancer.
Yeah.
When we examine patients, we look for risk factors.
Mm-hmm.
So prostate cancer can be hereditary, familiar,
mm-hmm.
familial.
Mm-hmm.
It can be sporadic. Sporadic, we say 80% of men by the age of 80 will have prostate cancer.
Yeah.
So we just need to live long enough.
Mm-hmm.
In hereditary familial prostate cancers, mm-hmm. there is a history that the patient gives. A father with prostate cancer, brothers with prostate cancer. So when we talk genetics, it's related to chromosome 1.
Yeah.
Okay. Q24, 25, and three members in a nucleus family with prostate cancer, or three generations,
mm-hmm.
or we say two people in a family that is younger than 55 years old.
Yeah.
So it's strong genetics. Many a time you don't get that history,
mm-hmm.
and then it is better to be proactive and just examine the patients. Your age is very important.
Yeah.
That's risk factors. And obviously your environment. So if people live in the Americas,
mm.
they have higher risk than people that live in Japan.
Yeah.
But once that Japanese person locate to the USA, it mm. takes 2 to 3 generations, then the risk is the same as for the American person.
Yeah.
Here in Africa, our risk is very high.
Mm-hmm.
Most likely because of our diet.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll get back to that. And then your hormones play a role.
Yeah.
And your race play a role.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens with dark-skinned people, the absorption of vitamin D isn't adequate.
Yeah.
So that's their higher risk for prostate mm-hmm. cancer. So those are the risk factors. Age, genetics, hormones, race, and location or in your environment, what you eat.
And by the way, the vitamin D is absorbed from the sun.
Yes.
So the people with more melanin must expose themselves more to the sun.
But yes, but the sun
is causing more problems.
Problems.
Yeah, it's causing squamous cell carcinoma
yeah.
and other skin cancers. So what then need to happen when you discover that Okay, what do you look at, doctor, and when examining the prostate?
Yes, so you would do a general examination when you examine a prostate patient.
Yeah.
Not just the prostate.
Yeah.
And you also examine the kidneys because we look for kidney cancer.
Yeah.
You look at the testicles, you examine the prostate.
Yeah.
So basically everything.
Mm-hmm. And by the way, those are in a close proximity.
Yeah.
The testicles, the prostate, and the kidneys are almost in the same triangle.
Yes, because Dr. Furch always says that the textbooks don't follow the rules. If you say you get kidney cancer in the age group of 50 to 70, it's really alarming when you find a 29-year-old that walk into your office with a 10-centimeter kidney tumor.
Yeah.
So that patient have taught me, if patients are 25 years old, I do ultrasounds to check the kidneys.
Yeah.
And I explain 13 years old to how to examine the testicles, because it is important that the information get out to the patients.
And by the way, last week I had a patient who came in and said they just buried their loved one who was 23 years old, and he died of prostate cancer. So it was something that I couldn't comprehend.
But 23 is too young.
Yeah.
It most likely wasn't prostate. It could be testis cancer.
Yeah.
But not prostate. It's too young for prostate cancer.
Mm-hmm.
Testis cancer you get from the age group of 15 to 40.
Yeah.
That's what the textbook says.
Yeah.
Until you get a 67-year-old man that comes in with testis cancer.
Mm-hmm.
So even though the textbook says up to the age of 40, you continue examining testicles and you explain to every patient the first of every month, you examine your testicles.
Mm-hmm. And how do we do that?
Well, you have two testicles.
Mm-hmm.
In winter, in the shower,
yeah,
when the heat of the water relaxes the scrotum,
yeah,
and you examine every testicle with two hands,
mm-hmm,
and you feel for anything hard on your testis,
yeah,
not on the epididymis,
mm-hmm,
and the testis.
Yeah.
And you have two, so you can compare them with each other to see if it's more or less. And if something is wrong, go to your GP,
mm-hmm,
or go to your mother and father.
So we basically look for some humps and bumps.
Anything hard is cancer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So okay. The same on the prostate.
Okay.
So when I examine a prostate, you need to feel it. If anything is hard, it should send off signals that something is wrong.
So, doctor, how do we do this examination? Because I've seen so many men saying, you put what where? Never! I'll never do it. You put your finger in my exhaust.
Mm.
There's no way you can do that.
Mm.
How is it done?
Okay. So, what would make me... You will definitely examine your patient if your patient is over a certain age. There are different ways of doing left lateral position.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's a fetal position, and I think the people are more comfortable with that.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can make the patient bend over the desk and examine the prostate.
How?
By making the patient stand over the bed.
Yeah.
With the pants down, and then you feel the prostate.
We feel it with what? With what? I want us to go there, doctor.
With one finger, your right index finger.
Yes, that's called a digital examination. So men must know that a digital examination is part of checkup for your prostate. So in your exhaust, there in the back, the doctor is going to put gloves, put KY gel there, and go in and feel the texture of your prostate, how hard it is, how soft it is, how big it is. So you should just gear up yourself to know that it's going to be part of the examination. So men, you must just know that that's part of the deal. If you want to know about your prostate health, you must do that. Many men keep quiet about their prostate problems because they are scared of that part. So, doctor, what else do we examine?
So, what I do is when a patient come in, I explain to them what I do. Because I think it's weird and uncomfortable for patient if you just go ahead and put your finger in where it is, where it shouldn't be.
Mm-hmm.
So once you give a good explanation, then things are acceptable mm-hmm. to the patient. So if the patient refuse, and I've had a patient that said he didn't want it,
mm-hmm.
then you just make a note that the patient refused the exam.
Mm-hmm.
But it's important to explain it. Because, I mean, if you as a female lie there, and somebody would just pushes his fingers into your vagina, it would not be acceptable. It's good when somebody explains.
Mm-hmm.
Then things are acceptable.
Yeah.
So if I have a high PSA, or if I feel anything wrong on my finger with a normal PSA even, or the PSA is up, then I go and do prostate biopsies.
Mm-hmm.
But that feeling...
Okay, before we go to prostate biopsies, doc, what's the range? What's the normal range for the PSA? What would consider above the norm?
So, if it goes with age,
yeah.
So any man that is younger than 50 should be less than 2.5.
Yes.
And people between 50 and 70, mm-hmm. we work less than 4.
Yeah.
And when people become older than 70, then we go age-related again.
Yeah.
Or if you just go age-related all the way, it is younger than 50 is less than 2.5, younger than 60 less than 3.5, younger than 70 less than 4.5, younger than 80 less than 5.5.
Yeah.
If you want to go age-related.
Yeah.
So it should be one within the normal range. Then there are other tests that you can do if you want to know. Say if I've done a prostate biopsy on somebody and I don't want to do unnecessary biopsies, then I do a ratio.
Mm-hmm.
You do the total and you do a ratio of the prostate cancer.
Yeah.
For prostate cancer. So if my PSA now is between 4 and 10 and I don't want to do unnecessary prostate biopsies, I do the ratio. It comes as a kit.
Mm-hmm.
And if that ratio is high, then that patient has most likely BPH.
Yeah.
But if the ratio is low, then that patient is sitting with prostate cancer. So, again, alarm lights go on, you go and do a prostate biopsy. Then there's something called PSA velocity.
Yeah.
So if you do your PSA every 6 months,
yeah,
then the last PSA minus the second PSA.
Mm-hmm.
Plus the second PSA minus the first PSA, and you divide that by 2.
Mm-hmm.
If that velocity climbs greater than 0.75 nanograms per milliliter,
mm-hmm.
it should also make alarm lights go. But so a PSA ratio is only valid between 4 and 10.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, basically, I want us to come back to the biopsy.
Mm.
How is the biopsy done?
You can either do it awake, when the patient is awake.
Yeah.
Explain to the patient that the gun makes a noise,
mm-hmm.
and that the same way that you feel it, you are going to most likely do about 12 biopsies.
Yeah.
We call them sextant biopsies. So in 6 different places in the prostate, you will shoot 2.
Yeah.
Two. It's a magnum gun.
Yeah.
It shoots a core out.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to do more like saturation biopsies, take the patient to theater,
mm-hmm.
and put the patient to sleep, because it is extremely uncomfortable if you go in there 18 to 24 times.
Yeah. And basically, with the biopsy, the tissue is sent to a cellular pathology laboratory, and they discover what stage the cancer is.
No, they will just confirm the cancer for you.
Yeah.
So what you use, we use a TNM classification.
Yeah.
So if there is cancer, then the pathologist will tell you it's an adenocarcinoma.
Yeah.
And it is, we do what we call patterns.
Yeah.
So we have 5 patterns,
mm-hmm.
and it means it's the rate of growth. Now, 1, 2, and 3, they are slow-growing cancers.
Mm-hmm.
4 and 5 are aggressive cancers. They grow very fast.
Yeah.
So they will just tell you there's cancer. And after that, then you stage the patient.
Yeah.
So it's important what they grade it as,
mm-hmm.
what your finger tells you it is.
Yeah.
And then the N is for lymph nodes, which we wouldn't know unless we do more tests.
Yeah.
And then to see if it's confined to the prostate, these days we do MRIs.
Yeah.
That they tell us. If we have, if we are afraid, or you get something called a nomogram, then you put all your information in there and they will tell you the risk for having cancer out of the prostate is, say, 10%.
Yeah.
And that might make you do other things.
Yeah.
So with further tests, and that only gets done about 6 to 8 weeks after the prostate biopsies,
yeah.
then you can stage the cancer to say, okay, it's confined to the prostate or it is out of the prostate.
Mm-hmm.
But cancer is a multidisciplinary team that decides about it.
Yeah.
It's not one doctor's decision.
Yeah.
So we have a very good uro-oncology meeting every second Wednesday morning, mm-hmm. where we have the urologists together, we have the chemo-oncologists and the radiation oncologists together, that is with Dr. Zietzman at Windhoek Central Hospital.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we discuss every single patient that belongs to urology that any one of us has seen within the 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And then we discuss our patient. And sometimes we bring them in if they want to see other doctors and want to have other opinions.
Yeah.
Because it is important for the patient.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's very important to understand all this information. This information we are giving you today is to empower you to be able to know exactly how this is diagnosed, the stages of the cancer. That's why we said on our advert we said phases of cancer, of prostate cancer. So you would understand that going to your GP at least twice a year. If twice is too much, at least once a year, just go do your general checkup. That's why we have chosen Movember to encourage men to go for their tests just before Christmas, so that they know their status of all the problems that they might have. I'm talking like this because I was also diagnosed with prostate cancer about 5 years ago, and it was something that really shattered me. I didn't expect to hear that because I regularly do my tests every year. But in this particular year, when I went, I was told that my PSA is a bit high, and then the GP referred me to Dr. Fetch, who took over my case, and Dr. Fetch did the digital test, which also he explained to me why the digital test it must be done, and I understood and consented to him doing the digital test. And then after the digital test, we did the biopsy, and the biopsy came positive, and I went into a bit of depression that time. And thanks to my wife, Bawini Lemoloi, and my family, who were always there by my side all the time, going to MRI scans. I did a whole lot of tests during that time. And because I went in
ikhulelo shiwike jo fandisa onene oko okay o jetirira ondudumo omnene we to khubisa mwambika o kampunda ko kothewa yo nesti free coffee o harama masera kita to hapo di sururwa ko mino gheri no we at the o kando pi komuta yo rama original o harama masera kata no landa dzili mbali ko dora shikomiro ngwa ne at the brooks or squasha ya pamanari ko mijo ka oroka o litera dzili mbali ko dora mino ngwa tuke khaimwe o fandisa ri komas ko ganage ke etines o sondaha ina kwatero atho okay express oko okay akoke.
Hi, my name is Rosa.
Sorry about that technical glitch. We'll go back to my story. And as I said, my wife was always there by my side. And I actually came off the depression part of it, because as if you've got support at home, it's very important, because she was there with me and said, we are going to conquer this. And I went to surgery. It was called brachytherapy, where seeds, it's like a staple cut into four pieces, one staple cut into four pieces, and those are radiation seeds that are implanted into the prostate, and voila, there I am. I'm fine now. All I do is just to do follow up every 6 months. I do my PSA tests, and for the past years it's been about 1.6 and below, and I'm quite healthy and fine. And the other day, a friend of mine who's here now spoke to me and he said, hey, my brother, hey, I've got this thing here. I just want him to talk about his part. This is Tangeni Amupadhi.
Thank you, doctors. I'm actually in good hands here. Dr. Stelmacher is what I call my private tools doctor. In fact, I talk with my friends. My friends, we tease each other, and I say, at least I've got a woman doctor to examine and keep my private tools healthy.
Yeah,
you know, not another man.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why a lot of my fellow male friends, some of them are simply really afraid to go to a doctor for a test.
Uh-huh.
And I, having myself gotten this rude awakening of being told in very kind, soft terms, you've got cancer.
So what was your first reaction?
I was definitely shocked.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe so shocked I seemed like nothing happened. I mean, I remember when I was walking out of the after Dr. Stelmacher's
consultation,
she's asking me, "Are you all right?" I think I was just basically shell shocked.
Mm-hmm.
One, because I believe I have been living a very healthy life for at least 20, 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I love my greens. I love to exercise.
And by the way, you also do Desert Dash.
Yes.
Yeah, that should be very grueling and and very serious exercise there.
Keeps me.
And he doesn't have a family history of prostate.
And I don't even have a family history, at least not that I know of.
Yeah.
The shock was much more so also because about a year before the diagnosis, my GP referred me to Dr. Stelmacher, and she did that finger examination, and she felt my prostate was still feeling great.
Mm-hmm.
Soft.
Mm-hmm.
Soft, so no need to do anything radical. She put me on medication. Maybe I should backtrack a bit.
Yeah.
How my GP came to refer me to Dr. Stelmacher.
Mm-hmm.
It was just I used to do regular medical checkups.
Mm-hmm.
Almost every year, I mean, not so diligently. But it never really got into my head to ask my GP specifically to do to look at prostate.
Mm-hmm.
Only the GP then actually only said we must insist on it when I turn 50.
Yeah.
I think he may have done it in my early 40s, and nothing was detected. So he said, yeah, at your age, how healthy you are, maybe we should just start at 50. 2 to 3 years ago, now I'm speculating.
Mm-hmm.
I just started having these regular erections,
mm-hmm.
which I don't know where they come from. And if I went to the GP, gave me some treatment, they disappeared. But then my peeing started getting weaker. And then at my next regular test, I was 49.
Mm-hmm.
That's when the doctor, then the PG, Dr. Ngalipo, said, now we have to start with including prostate testing in your package of medical tests.
Mm-hmm. For the prostate-specific antigen.
Right,
yeah.
The PSA.
Yeah.
And then that's where it showed it was elevated. I was, I think, at over six points.
It was seven, yes.
Was it seven already?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So then Dr. Stelmacher did the physical finger examination. It was soft. Gave me some medication, and believe you me, as much as some of us think we are diligent, I just got negligent.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't go back because the medication suddenly fixed my peeing, my peeing was now again strong.
Yeah,
my sex was also good.
I just want to come in there. When it comes to peeing, it sometimes it becomes start and stop. If your prostate is swollen, so you won't have one stream of urination. You start and stop. When you zip up, when you're about to go, you feel, I need to go back. I didn't finish. You go back, and sometimes it's very drippy. It comes just out very slowly. So I just wanted to clarify that part of the urination. So something like Uromax is usually prescribed by the specialist to make your urine flow much better. But if you've got those symptoms where when you're urinating you feel like you've not completely emptied your bladder, it's one of the signs of having a prostate problem. See your doctor. You can continue from there.
So in that case, it's mostly BPH and not prostate cancer.
Yeah.
But Tangeni, we will get back. Let's first finish the prostate cancer thing then.
Okay.
Everybody is attentive.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I got negligent, didn't go back because I thought, okay, it was just a minor thing. It was solved. Only a year later, after again my regular test, my GP said, now something can't be right. Did you go to Dr. Stelmacher? I said, yes, I did. She gave me medication. She didn't find my prostate as she found it soft, which means it was good.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, no, go back. Go back to Dr. Stelmacher. And then I went back. She did her own PSA test. It was at 8, I think, this time,
yes.
Which means it had gone up.
It was elevated, yes.
Elevated.
Mm-hmm.
And then she decided to do what I had to, only recently, despite knowing some of these English words, only recently did I realize what a biopsy actually is. You know, she then said, we have to do a biopsy. We will take a sample of your
tissue
so that we can see. And that is after the sample was done. On the 1st of August, I will never forget that day. The doctor then called me in, said, in fact, I was asked to come with my wife. Unfortunately, Nankelo was not in town. And I even said, I asked Melissa at your practice, can I not just put her on speakerphone? Mm-hmm. And Melissa said, no, that won't be a good idea. We don't know where she is, what she's doing. So that's not what we're going to do. Come and then we'll see. So the doctor broke the news to me.
Yeah.
It came back positive. And before that, I think we have been talking. I've been asking Dr. Stelmacher to come here and talk to us, to men, about the importance of going for tests.
Mm-hmm.
Mind you, that was the last year.
Yeah.
Mind you, that time I felt I was clear. No need to talk about take it to this level. And she's a shy person, even right now here. When she speaks and you are behind the curtains, you will think she's not shy, but wait until you ask her, come, let's go public.
Mm-hmm.
She was quite reluctant, but she made it clear to me there are a lot of Namibian men who are suffering in silence. It was the first time I learned you can get paralyzed by prostate cancer. People have back problems. I think, doctor, you said?
The big problem is if prostate cancer spreads. So the reason why we do early tests is that you can detect the cancer when it's a T1, where mm-hmm. you feel nothing.
Yeah.
But the PSA make you do the blood,
mm-hmm.
do the prostate biopsy.
Yeah.
Or T2, where you feel something odd or abnormal.
Mm-hmm.
Those two stages you can cure.
Yeah.
That's why we are checking for it. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing for a woman that becomes sexually active that go for pap smears.
Yeah.
Exactly the same.
But it's amazing how women take their tests very simple, and
absolutely
they tend to talk about these things, but men tend to be reserved and not talk about their problems.
Yeah, the egos of men are big,
yeah.
and the woman knows she has to get her children grown up, so something cannot happen to them. But you also get women that tend or look after men that are sick, and then they don't care for themselves.
Yeah,
especially regarding breast cancer.
Yeah, yeah.
You said something mm-hmm. earlier that is for me very important. If a patient has cancer,
yeah.
I always tell that person to bring family members along.
Yeah.
Because I think 4 years are better than two.
Yeah.
And the more people there are, the better.
Mm-hmm.
And when the person is older, I ask them to bring the children in.
Yeah.
Because these days you can look up anything.
Yeah.
And it is good for me if the younger generation, because they also need to be informed, is part of the whole process.
Yeah.
Because if I tell you have cancer,
mm-hmm.
it's like telling somebody close to you died.
Mm-hmm.
You go through the same phases of mourning,
yeah.
where you are in denial and angry, and until you accept it in stage five.
Mm-hmm.
So that family support
it
is crucial.
I saw that with my wife Bawindile, who was at every appointment with me, and I would allow her to be, even when they're doing the biopsy, to be in the room so that she understands exactly. So I share the burden with her. So mentally, it actually elevated me that at least I'm sharing this, my pain with someone close to me. And as I say, the rest is history. There I am, I'm fine now. There's no problems. And according to statistics here in Namibia, by the Cancer Association, it stipulates that prostate cancer has now been classified as the most common cancer among Namibians, with about 350 new cases detected annually. 350 cases detected annually in a population of 2.6 million That's quite a big number, doctor.
And that is if they come. So
yeah.
If many of them don't come, then those numbers are higher.
Yeah. So basically, they are higher than 350 per year.
Yeah, because I don't think all men come.
Yeah.
And maybe for me, the underlying thing is it's the leading cancer among Namibians.
Yeah.
The whole population.
Yeah.
And prostate cancer is really affecting only men, right?
Mm-hmm.
Only me.
So, which means there is a major, major problem out there. And that's one of the reasons why, despite prostate cancer being, or generally cancer actually, people just fear. You hear cancer and it's like death is at the door,
yeah.
Which in many cases I'm sure it is. But with prostate cancer, it's even more problematic. Because us men will go, me, somebody's finger up my anus. No ways, I'm not going to allow that. Or, aha, the tools, that guy can no longer get it up. So it's no longer a man. And a lot of people don't even bother to want to get to that point of being checked.
Yeah.
But the sad reality is, if that person has metastatic cancer, when you become paralyzed because you didn't go for checkups, then and you're paralyzed, then nothing works. Your legs don't work. Your bladder doesn't work. Your stool, it
you
doesn't.
You can't control.
That's not a life. That is no quality of life. So a regular checkup for men is important. Whether you like it or not, it's important, because when you pick things up early, you can cure it. When you pick it up late, you cannot cure it. And I always tell people, I can still do a lot, even if it is out of the prostate. But to become paralyzed from prostate cancer, we have a good medical system.
Yeah.
And
talk about my stage, though.
And doctors should examine patients. I tell the medical officers in Windhoek Central Hospital,
yeah,
once a year, at least once a year, you examine your patient fully.
Yeah.
So if you do a PSA in a digital rectal examination once a year, you've done your work properly.
Yeah.
If you only do PSAs, you only pick up 25% of cancers.
Yeah.
If I only do a rectal, I only pick up 30% of cancers. If I do it together, I pick up 60% of cancers.
Wow.
And if I do it yearly, I pick up 90% of cancers. That's the reason. With a family history, from 35, we examine you every year.
Yeah.
You might never get it, but we want to pick it up
as early as possible.
Yeah, as a T1.
Yeah.
Or T2.
Mm-hmm.
And Tangeni, the only thing that was abnormal was his PSA. And clinically it's a T1. So it's early.
Yeah.
And that's where we want to catch you.
Yeah.
Because it's about cure. Nothing less.
So Tangeni, where at what stage are we at now?
Okay, it was picked up early.
He's a grade 2 T1.
Okay.
Which means he's actually a T1C. The T1C, the C means that the PSA made me do the prostate biopsy.
Yeah.
And the grade 1 is a grade 2. He's a Gleason. So it's the two primary patterns that are present when you do the biopsies.
Yeah.
Those are the two things that add up. So he's a Gleason 3+3, which is a grade 2.
And what does that mean in layman terms?
It's remember, a Gleason 1, 2, and 3 are slow-growing cancers. So it's not a 4 and a 5.
Yeah.
They are very fast-growing.
So,
and when I feel your prostate, I feel nothing abnormal.
Mm-hmm.
It just feels a little bit bigger.
Mm-hmm.
So you just mentioned BPH symptoms, but we'll talk about that a little bit later.
Okay.
So you are early.
Mm-hmm.
I'm early.
You should be cured.
My chances of being cured are
much higher.
Much higher.
Ask that from me.
Aha. And next week, I'm going for my operation. I don't know what's it called. Treatment, what?
Brachytherapy. Which when we insert radioactive seeds, they come from America.
Yeah.
And put the patient to sleep, and then we insert the seeds.
Mm-hmm.
So they are radioactive, and they destroy the cancer cells with the radioactivity.
Mm-hmm.
So prostate cancer is sensitive to radiotherapy.
Yeah. And I'm a product of that. I can attest to it. And I've got back to a good quality life with my family. And I'm willing to share the path with any man who wants to talk. He was actually the first one to talk to me, and he was just talking about it, and I said, I'm from the same path.
And communication is a great thing.
Yeah,
we should open up and we should explain stuff.
Yeah, we really
and make a difference for the next person.
Yeah, we need to demystify this thing. People say prostate, your penis problems. Ah, that guy has got penis problems and what and what.
And all those things are not true.
Completely from a misunderstanding. Uh-huh. A friend of mine, by the way, Mark Samata, lost his job because he ran a story about President Sam Nujoma having prostate. And I'm thinking the comments that were out there was, how dare he play with the old man's balls? You know, just the way it was framed became a negative issue.
Yeah.
And therefore it drives the talking about it even underground.
Yeah.
So
we should care enough that we can share our stories and make a difference for the next person. And it should never be done in a negative and a derogatory way. It's about caring about our people.
Yeah. As we are about to wrap up now, so what's the next step for you, Tangeni?
Treatment.
Yeah.
Which is scheduled for the 30th of November.
That means it's next week.
November month for me is ending on a very high note.
Yeah.
And I would want to take this time to share in future how it's progressing. But doctor, maybe you can just help us explain, what I should be doing. Should I be happy after the treatment all is done?
Of course.
Basically after the treatment, there's nothing much you get to do, because
but there's a waiting period, isn't it?
Because the seeds,
whether it's successful.
So the thing that tells you if you're cured from cancer is time.
Yes.
So how we follow up is a PSA every 3 months for 2 years.
Yes.
Then every 6 months for 2 years.
Yeah.
And then every year.
Yeah.
So no more rectal examination.
There's no more rectal examination.
PSA values we follow up.
Yeah. As I said, I'm at 1.66, and basically I'm good to go.
Mm.
And I'm so happy that you came in and to talk about your story. And Dr. Stellmacher, thank you very much for coming to us and demystify the prostate health. And we hope to have you talking about other male and urinary problems, both in females and males, so that we get educated as a nation.
Yeah, I think the next you should probably do one regarding diet.
Yeah,
because diet plays a very big role in prostate cancer.
Yeah,
and I think in other cancers. So if you do one, diet is important.
Well, this show is on every week from now on, so Dr. Kagiso Moloi will be looking at different health.
Yeah, basically the Pulse is going to be broadcast every Friday from 3 to 4, brought to you by the bold voice and by the good self, Dr. Kagiso KG Moloi, right here on Desert Radio. Thank you very much for listening, and we hope that if you've got any inquiries or any questions, you might send them to our to our numbers that you will provide to you. And thank you very much, Tangeni, for enlightening us and for coming out. I'm very proud of you. You came out and we are going to save the nation. We are actually heroes. We are going to save this nation. I, for one, I'm a really a proponent of education, especially health education, that I've been doing for the past couple of years. Mm-hmm. I've got a show on. I go to television to do my oral health education and other health issues. And also, I've been doing this health education for the past 10 years mm-hmm. on radio. And it has given me a purpose to live, not only doing my career as a dentist or dental surgeon, it has given me a purpose to be of help to the next human being, not necessarily men. But to be specific, men is my main point of concern, because they don't talk, they keep quiet. So basically, I would like to say good afternoon to you, and we shall meet again right here on the Pulse next week, Friday, 3 to 4 p.m. Thank you.